It's so nice to see so many of you here. Welcome. This is going to be a great event. I'm just here to remind you, if you could take 1 minute to take a look and make sure that your cell phone is on silent and put away, just so we have no distractions. There will be a short Q&A after probably about 10 minutes to the hour, so start thinking about your questions. And there are books for sale, and Jennifer is happy to sign your book after the event. And our MFA in Writing student, Melise Galula, is going to give you the introductions.
Thanks, Paige. Good evening. It's my second week at Sarah Lawrence, and perhaps like you, I'm thinking about rock and roll. I'm thinking about how much Jennifer Egan loves The Who, how much Jacob Slichter loves Earth, Wind, and Fire, especially their pre-1976 work, yeah, and how much I have an abiding love for New Wave, especially Depeche Mode. I'm especially fascinated to learn that authors Jake and Jennifer have had an ongoing conversation about the connection between music and writing for more than a decade now. Both treat rock and roll as a subject of their books and as an instrument for the writer. The world of rock and roll is the stage for Jake's critically acclaimed memoir, So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star, about his time as a drummer in the Billboard ranking band Semisonic. And in Jennifer's 2010 Pulitzer-Prize winning novel, A Visit from the Goon Squad, interlocking narratives circle the lives of a former punk rocker turned aging record executive. But music is also the metaphorical prism for how she shows us the perils, the miseries, and hilarities of self and time in the digital age. In her latest book, The Candy House, a pick on former President Obama's 2022 summer reading list, she turns to the sugar-addled temptations of the tech era and its reverberations on the unconscious, memory, and the collective, all of us, like a song we can't get out of our heads. These authors today join us in conversation to explore some of the ways that music and the work of writing sample each other and intertwine. It's less about the lyrics of your favorite song and more about how its pauses, its gaps, its riffs, and the use of time become instruments in structural innovation, in play, and in prose. So without further ado, the Robies have set the stage, the amps are warm, the spotlight is hot. Let's welcome Jennifer Egan and Sarah Lawrence's own Jake Slichter to the stage.
Thank you so much, Melise. Welcome, Jennifer.
Thank you so much.
It's good to have you here.
I feel good to be here, and I am tempted to actually explain more fully how we met.
Please do that?
Because it really does relate, I think, to some of what we're going to talk about in terms of structure and how it functions in music and narrative, and in what ways narrative is musical and musical is narrative. So as I was working at A Visit from the Goon Squad, I was trying to do research on the music industry. I knew nothing about it. And I stumbled on Jake's book and read it, and it was, first of all, it's just so great. It's the best book I read about being in a rock and roll band, and I read a number of them. So good. There was one part that really preoccupied me, though, and it was about the production of Closing Time, a big hit of Semisonic's, in which is it a producer, Bob Clearmountain?
He's a mix engineer.
So the mix engineer, Bob Clearmountain, inserted a pause into Closing Time, which is really an important part of the song. And in fact, Bob Clearmountain, it turns out, is known for inserting pauses to such a degree that they are known as Clearmountain pauses. Well, this was just galvanizing to me, but I couldn't even figure out why. I just thought, pauses. I'd never thought about them before. They're so important. So I started collecting songs that had pauses, and I would run and only listen to songs that had pauses. And I kept thinking, I have to use pauses. I have to use this knowledge in A Visit from the Goon Squad. So my first idea was that I would have an academic who's studying pauses in rock and roll songs. This was a failed chapter. I was talking about this earlier. And so one reason this chapter failed was that this professor would spontaneously begin talking to other people in the chapter about how pauses functioned in songs, and it was really boring. I mean, she was boring, it was boring. So I finally just thought, okay, I can't, I don't know how to do this. And at very much at the last minute, I ended up putting in a PowerPoint, and in that structure, which is 50% pauses, which are all the pauses between all the slides, I was finally able to bring my Jake-inspired obsession with pauses into my book. So, of course, I thanked him in the acknowledgments because he had basically given me a chapter of my book, and in fact, the chapter that it's best known for and probably largely responsible for its success. So, thank you, Jake, again.
thank you, Bob.
And so Jake then, I guess, read the book and reached out to me, and we've been in touch since then.
Yeah.
So that's how we know each other.
It is. And, you know, one of the things, so as soon as I heard that I had been mentioned in the acknowledgments, that very day I was reading, I had purchased and was, after reading the acknowledgments, started reading the book. But I was immediately struck by how musical it is. I think a lot of times when people think about writing being musical, they're thinking about the sentences, and the sentences are musical. But I sort of noticed structural moves in the book that felt very much like music. And maybe, so you've written short stories, you have a collection of short stories, you've written full-length novels, that have central characters and sort of central plot lines, but A Visit from the Goon Squad and then your most recent book, The Candy House, which is sort of a companion to A Visit from the Goon Squad, have this sort of different approach where there's not a single main character and a single plot line, but overlapping, a sort of overlapping network of stories. Does that sound, would you say that?
Yeah, absolutely. Where I thought of it, I mean, to think of it musically as a more polyphonic book.
Yeah. Okay, so great. So one of the first thing I noticed was that I thought to myself, this is an album of stories, and this was not an original thought. I quickly saw that reviewers use this very analogy, so it was very clear. And in fact, Goon Squad is divided into A, chapters A, and then the next half of the chapters are B, like side A and B of an LP. And I thought, this is, oh my God. And I think one critic even sort of chose the phrase concept album, which I think is a really apt choice, because a concept album is not just a collection of things, it's a collection of things that sort of points towards something. And one of the things that happens when you make a concept album is you might have some creative constraints that might sort of govern exactly what is in and what is out and how you're going about doing it. So I'm kind of interested in what constraints or rules you might have had when writing these books, these two books.
Well, I should say, while the book is very clearly a concept album, I didn't actually think of it that way as I was working on it. I thought of it as a tangle. I mean, I'm always trying to find metaphors that explain what I'm doing. The reason that I divided it in half, and this is Goon Squad we're talking about, is that I had a mistaken idea that the chronology would go straight backward, which meant that the first half would be post 9/11 and the second half would be pre 9/11. And so that divide was really about a structural idea that ended up not working out. And so when I realized that actually read in that order, the chapters didn't gain any energy, and this is a concept we've talked about that I want to talk about more. It felt like the book sort of lost momentum as I read, not what we hope for. I realized that actually this backward chronology was a constraint that was not serving me. So I let it go, and I basically structured the book around curiosity. What is the most fun thing to encounter, having just encountered what we've encountered? And what that meant was that my division into two halves didn't really make sense anymore. But I had been calling them A and B, and so I thought, well, I'll hold on to that, because there's so much music in here. And I think in a way that was really the moment when I had almost finished the book that I thought, oh yeah, so this really is like an album. In terms of the constraints that did help me, they were really just three, which is that every chapter was about a different person, every chapter stood completely on its own, and every chapter felt like it was part of a different book from all of the other chapters. That was the one that was the hardest. And meeting those three criteria, it's not that I'm so rule-bound that if I somehow hadn't quite met one of them, I would dismiss a chapter just on that basis, but usually the ones that sort of just weren't alive and didn't work also didn't happen to meet any of those criteria. So those constraints were really proved to be actually very useful. And just one more thing about concept albums, which I wonder what you would say about this, but you know, when I was growing up in the 70s, there was something inherently literary or more overtly literary about a concept album because these were actual LPs, which often opened up, if it was a double album, like Quadrophenia, for example, one of my favorites, there were pages that you could turn and read the lyrics, and there would be artwork on those pages. So it felt book-like in certain ways. Would you agree with that?
I would agree, because one difference between listening to music then and now is that music was our portal into the adult world. We didn't have the internet, which is a much more efficient way of getting information. Back then, if you were, whatever age you were, listening to albums was a way of getting crucial information about the world, because other people would be talking about it. The new Who album, the new Pink Floyd album, the new Stevie Wonder album, whatever. So I think that partly it was that we didn't have all the other portals into the world, and so we were spending more time there, and the concept albums were the sort of highest form of that. I remember Stevie Wonder's album, The Secret Life of Plants, even had the scent of flowers coming out of it. It had a Braille cover and the scent of flowers coming out of it. So it was this really, like you say, a really rich, full sensory experience.
And there's also another thing that I'm just realizing now, which is the way you listen to music on an album is straight through.
Yes.
I mean, you can't exactly, you really cannot shuffle or you know, say, okay, I'm gonna just listen to that one again and again. That's actually really hard to do. So as a storytelling device, I think an album, an actual LP, was more effective because the creator had more control about the order in which the story would be told. That's something that we've lost.
Yeah,
to some degree.
I sometimes think that albums should now be released as apps. You can only hear the music within the app, and the app could dictate the order and prevent you from shuffling and rearranging things. Because now we definitely, I think albums, except for those who are sort of the vinyl folks have sort of reclaimed it. And vinyl does actually, I think it outsells all forms of music.
Is that true?
Yeah, it definitely outsells CDs. It's the highest selling form of physical music, of physical recordings. So I've thought that maybe someone ought to do that. I think I'm sure people have tried and then it just didn't work out. But we definitely have lost that. Like the sequence is no longer a thing. But you can have that in a book still.
Yeah, and it was funny when Goon Squad came out, they did make an app of it in England. And the idea was that the app user be able to shuffle the chapters.
No!
And I said, okay, I will let them do that only if they've read the entire thing through my way first. I'm not sure anyone actually purchased this app, so it ended up being sort of an academic question. But yeah, that idea of sequencing and the control over the narrative arc is kind of critical. I mean, if viewing an album as a narrative of its own, as opposed to the unit of the song. I mean, I guess it's a question for you. Do you feel like at this point the song matters more as a structural unit than the album because of these changes?
In the world, it does. I think for listeners, most people listen to one or two songs off of an album and then just go on and find the next cool song that they like. But when you're putting together, when you're an artist and you're making a record, the sequence is a really big deal. It's sort of like putting together a set when you're playing a show. You, in fact, you make mini sets. You make, you know, you might be playing 15 songs, and when we write, when my band writes, when we write out our set lists, the songs are grouped three, four, and five at a time. This is, you know, we're going to start out loud, then we're going to go sort of sideways into this kind of energy, and then we're going to sort of start doing this, and then at the end we have to just go, you know, the last 25 minutes to just be, you know, nonstop, tire the drummer out, kind of, you know, full speed rock and roll. So, so definitely thinking about that as someone, when you're sequencing an album, you're definitely thinking about that. So one of the things that's interesting in your books is that each chapter, as you mentioned, each chapter sort of focuses on a different person, sometimes multiple different people. And first of all, I just want to say that this is a, so one of the things I think about music and writing that's interesting is that I believe, and this is something I talk to writing students about, is that we've learned lots of lessons as listeners that we haven't yet put labels to, that are instantly, that are actually quite useful to us as writers. That we can, if we're able to sort of identify things and sort of recognize their use in music, suddenly we have the ability to make use of them in writing. So here, for instance, are a couple of examples of where, of works where there are multiple voices, and we're actually quite used to it. So here's a sort of... This is the Messiah, which is a multi-move, you know. We're fast-forwarding through it. That's it. So if you're at a concert seeing the Messiah, you see like all of these soloists up on this up on the stage. That was the contralto, this is the soprano. And they're all sort of waiting and taking turns. And there's a chorus. And it's not unusual for us to sort of to experience that. And one of the things that it does is it actually, by changing our which singer we're connected to with each movement, it actually draws our attention to the text itself. And so there's a kind of interesting thing that I think happens in both Goon Squad and Candy House, which is because this, the narrator, the narrative attention is on a different set of characters, we're connecting with them, but because we continue to shift, we start to notice more and more of the sort of network of things in the background. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, I mean, I think that is exactly the thing that using this sort of fragmentation lets me be able to do, to sort of suggest a big lateral sweep of human life. Mm-hmm. And actually not lateral in the sense that it's not all happening at the same time, but I guess in a way it sort of is for the reader. So it gives me a breadth that is really hard to achieve with a more centrally oriented narrative, which can still be very ambitious. I mean, and actually in certain ways it's harder to do. I think there are ways in which, you know, writing a more ensemble book relieves me of certain tasks that are actually really hard, like maintaining momentum in a more central way. But what it can do that is exciting is just let me tell a story that feels a little looser, a little more casual, and then hopefully also can snap into focus as one story. Mm-hmm. I mean, that feeling when the chorus comes on there, you know, I thought that's kind of what I was hoping to that's the feeling I wanted in the epistolary chapter in the book, where little by little, more and more voices come in, and suddenly we're just, it has a kind of choral quality.
Totally.
Even though I'm not, I should quickly say, not very well versed in music and don't particularly know musical terminology, but we all listen to music. We grow up with music of one kind or another, whether it's in church or going to jazz concerts or whatever. So I think that we absorb structural ideas from music, even if we're not musicians and can't read music.
Mm-hmm.
But one question I wanted to ask you, because I am interested in the some of the terms that you, even when you were describing the structure of a set, I love the language that you use to describe it. And I wonder if you could just talk about how a song gets made. I mean, I was just in a craft class talking about various aspects of the nuts and bolts of putting together a story or a chapter. I'm curious about how that happens with a song.
There's all different ways that it happens. Songs have been written in people's sleep, like they literally woke up and I've heard songs in my sleep, and you wake up and you transcribe them and then you go back to sleep, and then usually ideas that you get in the middle of the night that seem brilliant are not brilliant in the light of day. But that's one way. You know, one of my favorite examples of how songs get written is in the, if you saw the documentary about the Beatles, Get Back, the recent one, the Peter Jackson, there's a scene of McCartney just strumming away on his guitar, just, and then like 30 seconds later, he's got nothing, and then like 10 seconds later, he's got the first verse of Get Back, which was, you know, one of the big song on that album. And so it's just sort of staying there and massaging something. He had the germ of a kind of an idea, and it just sort of like goes. I think a lot of people say that it's easier when you write the words and the music at the same time. It becomes a sort of singular joined act, but of course a lot of songs get written, you know, there's a lyricist who writes lyrics and then they give them to a musician, or a musician will record a melody and say, I need lyrics, and the lyricist does that. But I think one thing that really has to happen is singing. That songs get written by singing. You have to kind of sing the song to write it, because it's ultimately made to be sung. And that's the medium in which it exists. So you can't, I learned this the hard way, you can't sort of find an awesome melody on piano and plunk it out and think of awesome words in your brain and then make them scan with the accent pattern of the melody. And then when you try and sing it, it's never works. You really have to just sing it. The words have to kind of wrap around the music that way. So I think that might be the best answer.
So the singing makes the song in a way.
I think. I mean, there's not one way to do it, but I think that's like the best way.
It's interesting because we were talking earlier, you know, I rely very heavily on a writing group, and in this writing group, we only read aloud. So, and there are all kinds of reasons for that. Some of them are practical, and we're all busy. We can just kind of have the experience there, and there's no homework. But I think above all, it's the feeling of attending to the music and the rhythm of the language. And often when there's an interesting relationship between that stuff and whether something is working or not. I mean, it doesn't mean that if you just fill up a piece with a bunch of lyricism that sounds really good, it's going to work. Not at all.
Yeah.
Sometimes language becomes sort of elevated. I'm really speaking about my own work here, and I've also heard it in other people's in the writing group. There's a kind of attempt to fix with lyricism or with language something that's actually weak and sort of not working on a deeper level. So there's a kind of forced quality to it. But anyway, a lot of these tensions and strains become much more obvious when reading aloud. And so it's an essential part of the process. And I think about all the time that, you know, storytelling began as an oral tradition, and that's where it started. And on some level, it is an auditory experience, because as we read, we are hearing it.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. For years, I tried to figure out why writing is so exhausting, which it is for me. I don't know.
I agree.
And I concluded that it's because I'm doing physical work as I write. Even if I'm just sitting here and just barely moving my fingers, there is work going in on inside of all of my body because I'm trying to think of it, and I'm sort of moving an imaginary medicine ball around in my being as I write. And so, you know, I go from like sitting at my computer for like an hour and a half, and then I lie down on the couch, like I'm exhausted. And it's so stupid because I've just been sitting here. But for some reason, and I think it's because writing is physical work, and it, because we think physically, we are embodied beings, we think physically. So that's why, just like singing is what has to happen when you're writing songs, hearing it in your head and I think actually speaking it out loud, reading it aloud is how you find out what it is that you've got.
And is that as hard work as writing prose for you?
Writing songs is harder than writing prose for me, but maybe not for that reason. For me, it's that I hate my singing voice, and I always think of myself as a fraud when I'm singing something and just trying to make it into something. Whereas when I'm, for some reason, I really feel much more like myself, for instance, at a book reading than playing a rock show.
That's so interesting.
Yeah, that's just a personality thing. I mean, I've gotten used to it now, and I love playing the drums. It's so fun. And it's the, if I'm in a rock club, I want to be on the drums, or I don't want to be there. But having said that, I do feel like I'm playing the part of a drummer in a way that maybe I don't quite, I feel like the Felix Unger of the rock and roll world. That's the neat, quiet member of the Odd Couple, the Neil Simon play. And I kind of feel like that guy a little bit when I'm at a rock show. Whereas because of my rock and roll past, I feel a little bit looser in a writing setting.
I think that helps to explain why your memoir really spoke so much to me, because I feel like it's someone like me who has this wild experience of becoming a rock star.
Right.
But it always feels like where I'm kind of on the same team with a sensibility that feels akin to yours, and getting to have this experience from that point of view is what is so fun.
Yeah.
It doesn't feel like you're having to translate for kind of a prose reader. It feels like you're actually now addressing your sort of true audience of like-minded, you know, observers.
Yeah. So, you know, when we got together a couple of weeks ago to talk, and one of the things you said to me was you wanted to cover more ground. Part of the reason you wanted to write a book where there would be different sort of focuses with each chapter was that you wanted to cover more ground. Can you just talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I mean, the way I think about fiction is as an act of compression at its most basic. Mm. So we're trying to suggest the really infinite complexity of human life and human perception, which are inextricably bound, in a work that is, even if it's very long, even if it's In Search of Lost Time, is really just, you know, minute compared to all of that enormity. The enormity of the world around us and the enormity and complexity of the human perception of it. So given that it's an act of compression, I'm always looking for ways to encompass more in less, because that's really the whole job. And that's what, you know, I think that is why the idea of the pauses was so striking to me, because there was something about that that felt like a structural idea that was gonna help me do something. I didn't know what it was, and obviously I was fumbling around because the dull academic was definitely not the answer. But the answer was actually PowerPoint. which is an extremely limited form in certain ways. It's not, you know, it's not like everyone is now writing fiction in PowerPoint. There are good reasons not to do it. Namely, it's very hard to portray action, almost impossible, because it's a totally atomized form. It just consists of individual moments, and it has kind of a cold corporate feel. But, and I had been, at the same time that I was trying to find a way to write about pauses, I was trying to find a way to use PowerPoint. And I thought, okay, well, what, you know, in a way, picked an analogously obvious idea to having an academic blab about pauses in songs. I thought, who's going to write, who's going to tell a story in PowerPoint? A corporate person. So I tried to write sort of a corporate story in this corporate genre. And the problem was even deeper than it feeling too corporate, which would have been an obvious problem, but I actually couldn't even do it. Like, the story just wouldn't live in that form. And I think in some way what I sensed in reading the specific and very granular description of the making of this song, it's very technical, is that somehow this was gonna help me use PowerPoint. And ultimately, the two fused into, and those are, that's actually something I should have said earlier in the Q&A. Usually really good solutions or ideas solve more than one problem. That's when you really know you've found an answer that's structurally sound, because many things get better when you use that. And it's interesting because you also, in our conversation a couple of weeks ago, we talked about the creation of So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star and how you applied some musical principles to a problem you were having there. And I found that very interesting. And I wonder if you could tell the group.
So one of the problems I had with my book was that I had cut some. I cut at least one chapter and maybe half of another after the first draft, but I still felt like I felt like I had probably cut as much as I could, and yet the beginning of the book was kind of a slow burn. It was like we weren't getting to the fun stuff. We were in the van, having stage fright, being unsuccessful, feeling, you know, bullied by life, and. And I just thought, that's just, you know, that's hard. And I thought, I need, when I was done writing the book, it was time to write an introduction, which is often the last thing you write. And as I wrote the introduction, I thought, I need to sort of promise them what is coming without giving it away. And I immediately thought of, like, overtures to musicals. If you go to a musical, the first thing that happens is the lights go down and then the pit orchestra plays. And what they play is like a medley of music from the whole show. And it does a number of things. I like this, what you said about like it solves different problems. The first thing it does is it plants the melody in your ear so that when it comes time for that song, it's like you've heard it before, because actually you have. The second thing it does is it sort of creates an emotional map of what is, you can kind of tell from a melody, or especially from a series of melodies, like what is the emotional contour of what we're about to encounter here on the stage. So it sort of helps you carve out a little bit of emotional space inside of you so that you go into the show with some vague expectations that help you sort of stay focused on what's happening, because you want to start putting the puzzle pieces in the various parts of you that have been carved out by the overture, if that makes sense. So I needed to, in my introduction, I needed to sort of just make reference to like red carpets, Grammys, autographs, you know, this and that, and but do it in a way that was, It was such a fast-moving montage that no particular scene could be remembered and then sort of telegraph something later in the book. It was just enough to make you want to sit in the van for two chapters and have stage fright with the narrator and eat Rolaids and play those shows and finally get to the part where there's record deals and now the promise of some success.
It's just so interesting. I love what you said about that feeling of knowing you've heard something before and the pleasure of that, because I feel like that's so much of what, you know, even writing fiction improvisationally as I do with my first drafts, that sense of recognizing something, of having seen it before and knowing, at least feeling that kind of spark of recognition, is such an important part always of narrative. And I remember you talked about it in terms of energy. I can't remember what do you remember the specific thing you said about the impact of recognition?
I don't remember exactly what I said, but I do know that energy is like such, we were talking about the physicality of writing, and I think part of the physicality is like holding in your body as you write, you know, like the kind of energy that you're hoping a particular moment or turn will have. You know, in the candy house, for instance, there are some moves that get made that do this, and it can't be all this. It has to come down here so that this means something. But there is some of this, and it's very, I mean, again, as I read it, I was like, oh yeah, it's exactly how you do it. Like, we can talk about it in a bit, but there's a chapter, or you sort of referenced it earlier, there's a chapter called See Below, which is an email thread, that just is so wonderfully and actually hilariously just like it's going off in all different directions, but it comes at a point in the book where it makes sense. It would have been a totally different experience had it been the first thing. It could have been the first thing, actually, but then what do you do with the rest of the book? Because you've just come out and all of the fireworks have come off. Like when you go to a fireworks show, you know how they sort of do spoosh, ah, spoosh, oh, that's a cool one, shkapoosh, oh, that's a big one, you know? Then they space in a little, that's all music, really, right? Isn't it?
Absolutely.
And then, you know, of course, at the end, then they just like shpoosh, psh, and you know, then you're waiting for that, and then you know that it's done after there's a big, you know, sort of, and then finally one last, and everyone goes, oh, that was great, and then we walk home, and that, but that's isn't that a very musical kind of experience?
Oh my God, I wish I had a recording of that. Yes, absolutely, You said something interesting about a song as an energy unit, which I had never thought of exactly, but I relate to that very much. And when I was describing what the problem with Goon Squad in its backward chronology, that was a case of a concept. I mean, it made a lot of sense. It sounds, you know, really neat to have a backwards chronology in which post 9/11 is the first half and pre 9/11 is the second half. And in a way, it really speaks to the limitation of conceptualizing as a creative tool. I mean, I think it gets you so far, but in the end, the question is energy being produced or is it being sort of dissipated? And what I found was that it was dissipating. Mm. And when what you just described about the overture or the introduction, it's as if you want to kind of give us a running start so that then this softer couple of chapters of beginning, instead of feeling like, you know, what's going on? We're kind of going slow here. It feels like a wonderful contrast to this big overture and a promise of more excitement to come.
So one of the things I noticed when I was writing my book was that there would be quiet chapter. It would be sort of like a quiet chapter, loud chapter, quiet chapter, loud chapter. Quiet chapter meaning interior, narrator struggling, figuring things out. Loud chapter, big outward, you know, band doing public things and flashbulbs and cameras and recording and radio and audiences at live shows and spotlights. And it sort of, and I sort of thought, you know, that's very verse, chorus, because in a song, the chorus is usually the big loud part where everybody's singing and the horns come in and the tambourines happen. But then in the verse, things kind of settle down and get a little bit more focused. And at a certain point, I realized I need a bridge. I need to get away from this loud, soft thing and do something else. And what a bridge does is it sort of interrogates what has come before, and it changes it. So let me play an example. I'll play a very sort of abbreviated example of what we're talking about. So this is Girl from Ipanema, which you may know. There's a sort of AABA structure to that. And the bridge here is what's called in songwriting terms a middle eight. It's actually a middle 16 or something like that. It's not eight bars as it often is in standard sort of Tin Pan Alley 32 bar song structure. But the idea is the same, which is that it changes key, it changes musical landscape, modal landscape, but it also does something lyrically which challenges the main idea. So, up until the bridge in this song, we've seen like the girl from Ipanema walking down the beach, and each one she passes says, ah, and like, you know. But then the bridge focuses in on a particular person watching the girl from Ipanema, who's heartbroken. He can't tell her he loves her. And then the final refrain, and then it goes back to the A section, but the final line, instead of When she passes, each one she passes says, ah. The last A refrain ends, and when she passes, he smiles, but she doesn't see. Okay, so that B section has kind of changed the course of things.
And the B section is the...
is the bridge. Yeah, yeah. Da, 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 da. Okay. It goes to new musical terrain. It often changes key, and there's just like abundant examples of it. But there are also literary examples of this. Now, I didn't have this when I wrote my book, but when I read Goon Squad, and so the thing about a bridge is it has to happen after the halfway point. You have to have some momentum going into it, right? You have to have standard sort of expectations that then get violated by the bridge. When I was reading Goon Squad, right where a bridge would come is this, so, you know, here's these chapters, you know, each about a different person or set of people, and then comes this, right? It's this amazing PowerPoint chapter, which is a totally different mode. So you can sort of think of that as like the key change, the modal change. But then there's a different kind of change too, which is in terms of idea, because up until this point, all of the action, now this is just me, but this is my read on it. Up until this point, all of the attention has been on adults in the music business and their stuff, right? Their adult kind of stuff. And then it gets to this chapter, which is written by, how old is this boy in the chapter? He's like...
well, it's from the point of...
The point of the sister.
Yeah, the boy is 12, I think.
Yeah, the boy's 12, and his sister is like 15 or maybe? Or
no, I think she's...
is she younger?
Younger.
Okay.
Yeah, I think he's 12 and she's 11, I think.
Okay.
But it could be 13 and 12.
Okay, but he is obsessed. It's both... The focus of the chapter are two children who are 12 or younger. Mm-hmm. And suddenly it's just all about music and the fascination with how music works and pauses and things like that. So it goes very close in suddenly on music and a little bit on technology. And then the final chapter that follows it sort of explodes out into sort of like young people and their technology listening to music. Do you sort of see how there's a sort of like like transformation that kind of happens that way? And so it feels very bridge-like to me.
I mean, I didn't even know what a bridge was until you explained it. And honestly, I wanted to make sure I had the bridge part right when you just played that. So this is a good illustration of my lack of musical terminology, but I think what I'm doing is the same thing, yes, just by instinct.
Yes.
Like what needs to be here? Sort of like what's missing? You know, when you, that those are the kind of crude questions that I'm asking. But when you talked about the slow start of the memoir, like what's gonna make this not feel slow? That's the kind of question I'm asking. So with Goon Squad, when I went from my backwards order, which dissipated energy, to saying, okay, what am I gonna do here? What is the idea? It felt like the best way I could say it was, you know, what will be the most fun thing to encounter having just encountered what we have?
Right.
And the answer to that was usually some kind of recognition, you know, something that's been mentioned or alluded to in passing becomes central in the next chapter. And so that perspective shift, which I think is always fun, and also that feeling of seeing something different that may have quickly sparked curiosity and then being plunged into the middle of it also seemed kind of fun. But it's all about contrast and working against what's just happened in some way. So I love that idea of interrogating and sort of resisting what the what's been established as a way of kind of breaking us out to then return us feeling somehow different. And I think you're right that the email chapter to some degree does that, although there's a more radical chapter structurally, but it may not be performing that bridge role.
Is
I don't
that
know.
The chapter written in the second person?
Yeah, the one written in, that was tweeted originally.
Yeah, that felt very, this is in the candy house.
Yeah.
So the email chapter to me didn't feel like a bridge so much as maybe like a, almost like a finale, but it's not the final chapter. But it had the kind of energy of like the last movement of the Jupiter Symphony or something, where melodies from earlier movements have now been brought to the final thing and swirled around in this amazing sort of constellation of melodies and counter melodies that is just sort of like, whoa, it's all happening at once. I have a musical example of something that particular chapter sort of called to mind, and that is so what to notice here as you listen to this is how you really, you don't follow one melody, you just follow all of it at once. Try an experiment, find one voice, see if you can follow it. You'll just inevitably start following another. So that's a Palestrina mass. The very opening movement of a Palestrina mass, and I very much felt like one of the exciting things about reading that email thread chapter was that I just felt this feeling of things happening that I couldn't follow, and there was an excitement in sort of like the overflow of information was part of the fun of it for me.
That makes me so happy, because one thing that some people feel when they read both books, really, is this necessity of keeping track of everything, which is not at all something that I value in the reader. I mean, I think if it's fun to do it, great, but it's not homework. And what you said about, you know, follow a voice and you'll end up listening to a different voice. You following that voice, keeping track of that voice is not what these books are about. It's exactly the experience of letting one voice go and slipping into another and not necessarily having to be mindful of the larger structure of fact that unites them in some deep way.
Part of the trick of writing something like that is to be able to help me intuit, which I totally did. I'm not supposed to keep track. Like, I knew that, I can just let go. Sort of like, here's just another quick example of this kind of thing. So as you listen, that's Matana Roberts, who's a contemporary jazz artist, and that's from her extended work, Mississippi Moonchild. But again, like you're listening to that, you're not thinking, oh, I'm supposed to be that, oh, but then that, two bars later, that disappears. No, you're letting it sort of just do this to you.
Yeah, that's the hope, but the big challenge, and I mentioned earlier that there are some advantages to using this fragmentary form. There are certain things you can get away with not doing, but the big challenge is how to make it feel forward-moving enough and at least give a sense of some sort of landmass under all of this, uniting it, that it actually feels compelling. And I feel like this book in some ways is more decentralized than Goon Squad, which is almost inevitable because I'm moving into the outer rings
yes.
of characters. And
yeah.
So it's just obviously that those rings get larger. It's one reason I think it's really hard, even though I would love to do a third, it's sort of, I feel like I would have to take a totally different tack. There's no way to just make the ring even wider and hope to hold on to some kind of centrality.
Yeah, I felt like that's what that email chapter did, actually. It just went, whoop, there you are, okay? You got it? Like, there we go. And it sort of comes quiet after that. It ends, there's a lot of things that end with people looking up. That felt really important to me. A lot of moments end with people sort of looking up, and the book sort of ends that way. But the sort of like, the speedboat spoosh, spoosh, spoosh through all the different narratives in that email chapter just said to me, okay, yes, we're coming in for a landing here because we've kind of touching base, and it's not like sewing things up and like helping you sort of know exactly how each storyline ended. It's just like, it's all happening is all I'm supposed to know.
Yeah, and yet hopefully give the reader a sense of closure amidst all of that.
Yeah.
So that's the challenge. I'm curious, so you're working on your second book. What kinds of musical forms are you thinking of as you work on that?
I've gone around in circles on it. I think structure-wise right now, it's something that sort of starts quietly and sort of makes a surprising arrival at that same little quiet thing at the very end. I'm not sure that that's going to endure through the next draft. One thing I do is that sometimes I make a list of songs that I play and I'm like, this is the kind of book I want it to be. And at first I thought when I sat down to write this book, I was so, you know, I thought, oh, this is gonna be huge. And of course, that's like death right there. That's just like the worst kind of thought to have. Like seeing the finished thing as you start is like, for me, a really bad sign. But what I came to understand is that actually I sort of started identifying songs that were sort of small and quiet and listening to them and saying, let me try and do that. It's probably going to be louder than those particular songs. One of them is Don't Be Shy by Cat Stevens, which is also in the movie Harold and Maude. It's the opening scene, and but anyway, that's kind of some of the things I think about. You know, we've got a little bit of time left. I wonder if shall we open up for just like maybe one or two questions, if there are any. Yeah.
So the question is, there are a lot of use the word damaged people in Goon Squad, and how important was it to me to have to end on a more uplifting or sort of optimistic note? You know, I don't tend to, you know, sometimes these conversations are hard because we use different words to describe the same thing. So damaged is not a word I would ever think of exactly. Because I guess, you know, obviously there's the book does start with a person who has a big problem, which is a compulsion to steal. And when I published that as an individual short story, people tried to subtly, but it wasn't too subtle, ask me, like friends in the neighborhood, so is that, you know, have you struggled with that problem? And I felt that they were none too subtly thinking, okay, we gotta keep our eye on her when she brings her kids over to play. But and the answer is that I have not had that compulsion, but I mean, what human doesn't understand compulsion? And what human isn't what you might call damaged? I just think life is not easy for any of us. Obviously, much harder for some than others, but in terms of the sort of redemptive quality in that book, I think that the reason it felt necessary is that, and the reason that I felt like it would be satisfying, and when I wrote that piece, which I wrote still believing in my backward chronology, therefore thinking it had to be the first chapter because it happens the furthest in the future, I think what excited me about it and made me happy when I realized it would be the last chapter is that it seemed to work against, to provide a kind of contrast to a lot of the struggles that we've seen, and particularly a character named Scotty, whom we've seen really struggling in a very marginal, living a very marginal life when we see him at an earlier point, and in fact, arriving at the last chapter in that state, and yet somehow, by virtue of, you know, time, place, and a kind of will of the people around him being lifted up into a kind of iconic state, which seemed like the last possible thing we could imagine for this guy. And back to the idea of compression, and this is sort of an aesthetic principle of mine, nothing creates compression more than contrast. Because if we can do, and no contrast is more delicious than direct opposition. So if I can find my way into a state where something is both plausible and ridiculous, I am so delighted, because that is a kind of compression. If two opposites can be not just adjacent, but actually fused into one thing, that feels like a kind of energy unit, to use your phrase, and that's very exciting. So I'm always looking to work against what I've done, certainly project to project, but also within each project. You know, you talked about the back and forth of chapters, thinking like, yeah, the loud, soft, but then at a certain point, like, no, that's a binary that you also want to work against.
Yeah.
So just as a matter of sort of, I guess, aesthetic principle, I find the idea of resisting what I've been doing very, very helpful.
That's awesome. Cool, one more question.
I'm thinking about, I'm starting to kind of fragmented projects, like what you have
Did people hear that question, or should I repeat it? So the question is, with something that is occurring in smaller parts, or smaller structural units, that's more fragmentary approach to narrative, how can you create moments of convergence without it feeling contrived? It's a really good question. For me, as with most things, it was kind of instinctive, but interestingly, that one chapter of convergence was yet another attempt to do something that had failed a number of times, and I was trying to find a way, because I have a chapter that was originally tweeted that is called Lulu the Spy, in which a young woman is working as a spy for the government, a sort of civilian spy, and she's narrating her mission in the form of lessons she learned from it. And it's a very genre-esque piece, so we're not really thinking too hard about exactly what's happening to her, which is terrible. I mean, she's basically being raped and ultimately shot. And so one of the questions I had, a big challenge that hung over me as I worked on the Candy House, was if I'm going to include that chapter, I have to find a way to see Lulu after this mission is over. And how on earth to do that? Because in some way that would have to be a reckoning with what has actually happened to her. I don't have the crutch of genre anymore to make us not focus on it. It's sort of, an analogy would be, you know, a murder mystery is not usually about grieving. You know, that's not what we're reading for. But the impact of a murder or a death is enormous. So if we were going to sort of look at that from a different angle, we'd have to contend with this aspect of death that a genre like a murder mystery isn't focusing on. So I tried many different ways of doing this, and nothing worked. And finally, I hit on this idea of an epistolary form, which was on my list of things I wanted to do, as old as the novel itself, so kind of irresistible. And what was great about that was that I wasn't limited to Lulu's voice. So bringing in more people let me bring in, it was still telling the story of what, of Lulu's struggle to resume a conventional life after this extraordinary and painful thing that she's undergone, which has left her very traumatized. But it let me do it in a more, a more choral way, and to use humor, which turned out to be a really essential ingredient. So I think the answer is, for me anyway, go where the heat is in terms of narrative, and in the sort of evaluation phase of looking at what you have and what you need, recognize where, you know, it feels like good things are happening, and sort of lean into that. You mentioned something about songwriting, and I want you to remind me and all of us of it, which is something about when something's missing.
Yeah. So you might be writing a song, you say, something needs to happen here. Something, we need something here. And I think songwriters think that way. Sometimes I think writers could do more of that.
We need something here. I mean, that phrase is going to go on my wall, because that is in a way a perfect expression of the kind of blind quality of all of it. You know, there's a sense of something missing. What can it be? Often, you know, I think the reason instinct can be good is that following instinct can result in things not feeling as contrived. For me, contrivance comes through conceptualization. Ideas that seem like they'll be cool, but they feel contrived on the page. It's not that there's anything wrong with doing that, because if you can recognize that and move on, that's no problem. But you know, we need something here. Is that what we've said, or was it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Something needs to go here. Yeah. I find that very useful.
Well, thank you so much, Jennifer, for coming up here and
thank you, being Jake, with us. For the conversation.
And thank you to everyone here. I think there's some copies of Jennifer's book out in the hall, which Jennifer would be happy to sign if
Absolutely.
You're interested.
And we can keep the conversation going.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.